I know at the end of my last episode, I said that most news was starting to blend together a little bit. Well, apparently Donald Trump got that memo and decided to start a trade war with Europe, a trade war with Latin America, credibly threaten the WTO, and who knows, there's a major escalation in the trade war with China scheduled for December 15th if we don't figure that one out. Basically, the last few days have been just me scrolling down my news feed saying, that should be an episode, that should really be an episode, oh man, I need to talk about that. I'm growing a pretty extensive tab at my local coffee shop right now. Forget the to-go cup, can I have that espresso and an IV, please? Now today I'm going to attempt to do the impossible, and, well, just explain all the trade war stuff that's gone on Monday and Tuesday while maintaining my sanity. This was written a little hastily, as there's a lot to talk about from that short period of Monday and Tuesday of this week, and also the oral arguments from a huge Supreme Court Second Amendment case are being released on Friday, and I am so excited to dive into that. My goal here is to put all of these fractions of stories about trade you've probably heard mentioned in the background of impeachment coverage into one place, so we can just all know what's happening. I guess let's start from the beginning. On Monday, Donald Trump woke up early, feeling refreshed, and made an early morning presidential announcement of new steel tariffs on Argentina and Brazil. That sounds like a pretty good place to start.
Before departing for the NATO summit in London, US President Donald Trump reinstated tariffs on steel and aluminium imports from Brazil and Argentina because of their currency devaluations.
Of course, America took a bold stance against currency manipulators, with Trump taking to Twitter to write, "Brazil and Argentina have been presiding over a massive devaluation of their currencies, which is not good for our farmers. Therefore, effective immediately, I will restore the tariffs on all steel and aluminum that is shipped into the US from those countries." And wait, it looks like there's a second part to that tweet. "The Federal Reserve should likewise act so that countries, of which there are many, no longer take advantage of our strong dollar by further devaluing their currencies." Can you just, like, not make the second half of your tweet demonizing currency manipulators? Yeah, but we should totally do it too. I'm not saying your opinion is wrong, I'm just saying make the joke writing part of my job a little bit harder. At least two separate tweets. This was a pretty out-of-the-blue announcement that seemed to shock leaders of both countries and violate trade agreements that Donald Trump had made with those two countries the last time we tried to tariff pretty much the entire world's steel and aluminum supply about a year ago. In May of 2018, the United States announced that it had reached a major agreement with Brazil and Argentina that would cap their metal shipments at a specific volume each year. Well, that's out the window now. People are mainly perplexed because, well, I can't emphasize how out of the blue this all was. Why did we do this at this particular moment? Well, I mean, if Argentina was intentionally devaluing their currency, they did a really good job.
In Argentina, at a time when the country's economy is in crisis. Under its IMF bailout deal, the government has slashed public spending and raised taxes. Meanwhile, prices continue to soar. Unable to afford many basic goods, increasing numbers of people are turning to barter to survive.
Oh man, those economic masterminds. Let's copy that strategy. Because a huge economic crisis in Argentina is happening, that's gotten so bad they had to defer payments on their government debt, most people don't think they're actively manipulating their currency, but rather suffering the consequences of massive inflation. For example, our current Treasury Department, in their most recent report, found neither Argentina nor Brazil to be currency manipulators, but rather Argentina's suffering and their problems are dragging down Brazil. Now, I couldn't find any confident motivation for these sudden tariffs, but some seem to think it relates to the fact that, now that China isn't buying our soybeans anymore, Brazil and Argentina are exporting soybeans to them. Maybe we're trying to privately get them to stop sending China their soybeans? Maybe we're trying to send China a message that we're not scared of new tariffs and totally would keep up a trade fight into 2020 if we couldn't reach a deal soon? Or maybe they wouldn't investigate Elizabeth Warren. We'll probably find out what's going on soon though. Unfortunately, I can't do an entire episode about that because, well, that was breakfast. Then, just hours later, a new trade story fell into our laps.
The arbitrators from the WTO announcing that the US is now entitled to impose sanctions tariffs worth up to $7.5 billion on European products as a consequence of subsidies paid to Airbus during launch of aircraft over specific periods in the past.
Yes, the WTO gave us the green light to put tariffs on goods from the EU. Christmas came early for Trump this year. Now this decision is a little more complicated because, well, it was released in October, at which point our trade representative imposed tariffs on 10% of large civil EU aircraft and 20% on selected farm and other products, and said it would look at raising tariff rates and subjecting additional EU products to the tariffs. So what happened on Monday afternoon then? Well, a World Trade Organization panel ruled that the European Union had not complied with the order to end illegal subsidies for plane maker Airbus in October. The EU plans on appealing this decision, but that might be hard because the United States is on the cusp of preventing the WTO's appeal court, the appellate body, from ruling on any new appeals. We'll circle back to that later. That's more of a Tuesday issue. But at this point, we're still on lunch on Monday. I'm telling you, this was one hell of a two-day trading period. Because of this ruling, we're contemplating increasing the percentage on the tariffs we're charging on EU goods. So now it's late afternoon, and Trump is now in Europe for the NATO meeting, and boy did he come out swinging.
So this really hits a lot of the things that Trump said he wanted to hit in response to this digital tax that, you know, goes after Amazon and Google. So it's sparkling wine is on the list. You see cheeses, you see makeup, you see handbags, china, or you know, kind of porcelain dishes. It's really kind of going after some of these quintessentially French products.
That's right. Just when you thought French products couldn't get any more expensive, the United States is now proposing a 100% tariff on French goods. You're welcome for the warning to get your wife that perfume stocking stuffer now instead of 2 weeks from now. Now this is still in the war threatening France stage, so I'm not going to spend a ton of time on it because, oh man, I haven't even mentioned the China part to this episode yet. The logic of these tariffs has nothing to do with the WTO case I just mentioned, and is instead because all the major companies affected by this digital tax are American. As Bloomberg reports, they're American companies, Trump said, referring to Facebook, Google, and Twitter. If they're going to be taxed, the United States will tax them. Alright, so we're done with Monday now, right? Well, not quite yet, because as the sun was setting on Europe, it was rising somewhere else. At about midnight Monday, we saw...
The threat of more tariffs is looming. Chinese state media says the government will soon publish a blacklist of, quote, unreliable entities that could lead to sanctions against U.S. companies.
No, China! I thought we were going to be shaking hands on a phase one trade deal any day now. You're dropping this one on me 3/4 of the way through this episode? Well, okay, sleep's overrated. The Communist Party-backed Global Times said in a tweet early Tuesday that the list was being sped up in response to a bill by Republican Senator Marco Rubio requiring sanctions against Chinese officials involved in alleged abuses of Uyghur Muslims in the far west region of Xinjiang. Well, there's an episode in itself. Do you know the Congress passed a bill holding Chinese officials accountable for detaining more than 1 million Uyghur Muslims, and a separate bill about the Hong Kong protests? And China's not happy that Congress has somehow found their cojones. Now China publishing a list of US companies that they're gonna sanction because of unreliability would generally not be news, except there is a huge deadline approaching on December 15th.
It was determined that the tariff should be delayed to December 15th for certain articles. Products in this group include, for example, cell phones, laptop computers, video game consoles, certain toys, computer monitors, and certain items of footwear and clothing.
Yeah, if we don't get our act together by December 15th, forget steel and solar panels. There's going to be a 50% tariff on computers, toys, cell phones, video games. Talk about a war on Christmas! This trade war just got very real. So we'll see what happens in the next 11 days. But China, seriously, let's hold hands and sing Kumbaya. I have a non-glitchy microphone on the top of my Christmas list. So that sums up Monday. Don't worry though, things calm down a bit Tuesday. This was mostly made up of two stories. First,
the president roiled financial markets today when he suggested delaying a trade agreement with China until after the 2020 election. New tariffs on Chinese imports could take effect December 15th.
Cool, we're taking our time. Gonna hit the snooze button on those tariffs though, right? Can someone please leave a post-it note on the president's desk? Now, not much to say there, but phase one is looking not as close as I was hoping. The other main thing that happened Tuesday was the WTO anger I mentioned earlier. The World Trade Organization's appeals panel will cease to function starting December 11th, when one of its three remaining members plans to step down. Now you might be wondering, what's breaking down the WTO? Are the people finally listening to those 90s protesters? Not quite. I'll give you a hint as who's behind it. Guess. You'll be right. The crisis at the WTO was created by a US block on new appointments to the appellant body, which the Trump administration says has overstepped its mandate and infringes on American sovereignty. What? Trump failing to appoint the requisite number of people to a post? That is so out of character. And because people are leaving but not coming in, the WTO won't have the requisite number of people to rule on cases after December 11th. On Tuesday, WTO members met to determine whether retiring judges can still hear cases in the interim period between nominations. The internal feud may be rendered moot, though, however, if the United States follows through on its other threat to block the WTO's budget. Yeah, we're also declaring we're no longer paying our dues to the WTO. On Wednesday, they went to see if they can instead get that funding from China, India, the EU, and Turkey. This should really help us maintain the upper hand in all these trade wars we find ourselves entering. Sorry for such a scattershot episode, but man oh man, did a lot of really random trade stuff happen over a very concentrated period of time. I'm not sure if any of these stories are going to blow up in the news in the next few weeks, but between starting a trade war with Brazil and Argentina, winning a WTO case against the EU about Airbus, credibly threatening to destroy the WTO, threatening France, and China escalating the trade war with a quickly coming deadline, well, it feels like something newsworthy is going to come out of one of those situations soon. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube! I'd like to thank my patrons for helping me put out my videos. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news looking into the overlooked, join this growing group of exceptional individuals by clicking on the link in the description. Remember to subscribe, because if I get 1,000 of you, I can put that Patreon link as an icon in this part of the video. And wouldn't that just look gorgeous? Ring that bell if you want freedom to continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching!